Thank you so much, Marilyn and Donna and Robert and Dana for inviting me to do this today. It's such a pleasure to be with you. So let's just go ahead and dive in. I am a worrier by nature. When I was a young child, I was obsessed. Whenever I went on the subway with my family, I was obsessed with the idea that we might get separated. And according to my older siblings, I acted like a neurotic sheepdog, herding us all into subway cars in the short time between when the doors open and close. And today, I am the person who is almost always the first person at the gate at the airport for a flight. That is not me, by the way. That would be me if I lost weight, still went to the gym, and could grow facial hair. But I constantly worry about missing flights. And a few years ago, a colleague of mine on our project said, Maurice, in the 30 years you've been on the project, how many flights have you ever missed? And I said, none. And they said, well, then shouldn't that tell you that you shouldn't worry about that? But I do. So I'm going to put in a shameless plug for my latest worry, which is a worry about the fact that we may be contributing to the stress and anxiety of children who are deafblind by not providing opportunities for those individuals to experience closure, which is a basic human need that almost everybody has, unless you're a free spirit who named, you know, Rainbow Pony who practices twirling every weekend in Golden Gate Park. But most people require closure in their lives. And so I'm giving a talk on March 22nd as part of the Texas Symposium and the Network of the Americas event. So join me for that. That's my current worry. This is what I'm talking about today is my 2019 worry. And here's my 2019 worry. What if there are a lot of children out there who have diagnosed CVI, cerebral visual impairment, and who also might have central auditory processing disorder that we can't diagnose now and maybe can never diagnose? What if there are a lot of kids out there who, for whom their educators assume that it's possible to compensate with auditory information to compensate for the CVI? What if those kids exist, and what can we do to support that? And I'll talk all about that. So that's my current worry. So first of all, I do want to point out that I'm not talking today about auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, or ANSD. I'm focusing today on central auditory processing disorder, or what I will call the rest of the day CAPD. CAPD and ANSD are sometimes confused, but they are very, very different. Central auditory processing disorder is a brain-based problem. Auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder is really more like a sensory neural hearing loss. So sometimes they can look similar. And just as a point of reference here, a typical sensory neural hearing loss generally involves the outer hair cells in the cochlea, and auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, or ANSD, typically involves either the inner hair cells of the cochlea and or the auditory nerve from the cochlea up to the brain. So So it's a fine distinction. And there are people in the world who still don't even believe that auditory neuropathy is a real thing. But nobody questions whether or not central auditory processing disorder is a real thing. And just so you can have a list of these, I've included a list of some of the more common risk factors for ANSD. So you can read them there. I won't go into them. And I told the organizers of today's webinar that I'm happy to share these text slides with them so they can post them to you if you want them. Okay, so one of the main points I want to make today is that there are many risk factors that are common to both CVI and CAPD. And I've included some of them here. So let me just read them to you. Hypoxia, which is not enough oxygen. Anoxia, no oxygen. Prematurity, seizure disorders, prenatal drug exposure, cytomegalovirus, or commonly called CMV, meningitis, low birth weight, traumatic brain injury, hydrocephalus, and this is something I learned from Gordon Dutton in Scotland. If you've ever heard Dr. Gordon Dutton speak, whenever he uses medical terminology, he breaks it down. And I found that really helpful. So I've started doing the same thing. I stole the idea from him. Hydrocephalus, hydro meaning water, or in this case, really it's more fluid, and cephalus, brain. So fluid and brain. Hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. So hypoxic, meaning not enough oxygen. Ischemic, meaning not enough blood. And encephalopathy, meaning brain problem. So brain problem from not enough oxygen and not enough blood. And often that's called HIE. And then finally, the last one on this slide, hyperbilirubinemia. And I don't understand it exactly, but bilirubin is a yellow substance in the body. So hyper, too much. Bilirubin, that substance, anemia in the blood. So too much bilirubin in the blood. And hyperbilirubinemia typically causes the physical characteristics that we call jaundice. Okay, so think about these risk factors. These are risk factors that are common to both CVI and central auditory processing disorder. That's important to remember. So I have some signs of CAPD, and I will just go through these briefly because the point I'm going to be making is that we may be working with children who may not present these same signs in the way that school children who have acquired language and are diagnosed with CAPD when they reach second or third grade, which is a fairly typical age for this to be questioned, we may be looking at a different population. But some of the typical signs of CAPD are trouble paying attention to and remembering information presented orally, and maybe do better with visually acquired information. Problems carrying out multi-step directions given orally, or need to hear only one direction at a time and not a series of directions. Poor listening skills, more time needed to process information, distractibility, difficulty localizing sounds, difficulty hearing in noisy environments with a lot of competing sounds, difficulty understanding speech that is too fast, low academic performance, behavior problems, language difficulties, and I have some listed here, confusing syllable sequences, problems developing vocabulary and understanding language, and difficulty with reading, comprehension, spelling, and vocabulary. So, here's one of the big problems, and one of the main points that I'm making today is I am talking about children who may not now be able to be tested for CAPD and may never be able to be tested for CAPD. And I want to explain why that is. In order to test for CAPD and make an accurate diagnosis, a child has to have language. And tests for CAPD are almost never given on young children. So typically, testing for CAPD is not done until a child is maybe around the age of 7. Most of the tests are not valid for children younger than that. But testing for CAPD requires language. So what I want to do is I want to just show you one of the typical CAPD tests. And this test is called the Test of Auditory Processing Skills. And it's the third edition. It's one of the more commonly used CAPD tests, and people call it the TAPS 3. Now, I am not shilling for the TAPS 3. I'm just using this as an example. It's one of the most commonly used tests for CAPD, and one of the reasons why it's commonly used. I don't know if any of you don't live in the world of testing. You may not know this, but for those of you who do, you know this, that testing companies establish a rubric for who is qualified to give a specific test that they publish. And so this publishing company, for example, has four levels of qualifications for tests, A, B, C, and N. And the TAPS 3 is a level C assessment tool. So the TAPS 3 can either be given by somebody with a master's degree. And if they have a master's degree, they don't need additional training in administering the TAPS 3. Or they can have a bachelor's degree and then additional certification through the publishing company. So this TAPS 3 happens to be a level C test, so used a lot in school programs. And let me give you the main components of the TAPS 3. Okay.
Hey, Maurice, let's go ahead and do an interpreter switch, okay?
Okay, so the first section of the TAPS 3 is word discrimination. So the tester might say something like, listen to these two words and tell me if they are the same or different. Cruise, crude. Are those words the same or different? So that's word discrimination. By the way, these examples are all mine. They're not taken from the TAPS 3. Phonological segmentation. So that's where I might say something like, listen to this word, gold digger. Now say it without digger. So gold digger, now say it without digger, and the child would be expected to say gold. Okay, phonological blending is where I give you the distinct sounds of a word. So I might say, listen to these sounds. J, a, z. And now you put them together and the child says jazz. Number memory and number reverse are pretty straightforward. So number memory is might be like, I might say, listen to these, this sequence of numbers, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now you repeat those back to me. And the same thing with reverse. So listen to this, this sequence, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. And the child responds by repeating back what they hear. Okay, word memory. This might be it could be two words, it could be more, just a series of words that you read to the child and the child repeats them back. So it might be like person, woman, man, camera, TV. Sorry, I couldn't help that one. I had to stick that in. If any of you have followed the news over the past couple of years, you know that sequence of words. And so the child responds, person, woman, man, camera, TV. Okay, the next section is sentence memory. So I might say the sentence, the Southeast States webinar series is amazing. And they just repeat that back exactly as I say it. Okay, and then auditory comprehension. And here's my auditory comprehension example. Sometimes Chris Russell talks about CVI. So the question would be, what does Chris Russell talk about? And then finally, auditory reasoning. When Maurice is finished with work on Friday, he will have a glass of wine. And then the question to the child is, why will Maurice have a glass of wine? I wanted to make sure I got that right. So the question would be, when Maurice is finished with work on Friday, he will have a glass of wine. And the question for the child, why would Maurice have a glass of wine? Okay, the reason why I wanted to walk you through a typical CAPD test is that you can see that this test requires children to have language. My concern is children who have not yet acquired language and may never acquire language, we don't know that, but that are not using their hearing in a way that their family and their educational team is finding typical. So we're talking about kids who don't seem to be hearing in a typical way, but for whom these tests are not appropriate. So I'm going to talk about some CAPD interventions to consider. But before I do that, I want to say something really important. I would never say to a child's family or an individual's family or a school team that a child has auditory processing disorder based on my own opinion about the way that the child is functioning. I would never do that. What I'm saying here is that there are certain strategies that you can use in your practice that will support children who have CAPD or might have CAPD. And even more importantly, and I hate to use a hackneyed cliche, but here I go, a rising tide lifts all ships. These are strategies that help all children. All children benefit from the strategies I'm going to talk about. So if your approach is do no harm, there will not be any harm in doing any of these things I'm going to talk about. So if you have a child that you suspect may not be hearing in a typical way, these are some things you can do that will help the child and won't hurt anybody else in the program. So that's really important to remember. You can do these things and they will help all kids. So here they are. Decrease auditory clutter. And we're going to go through each of these separately. Decrease auditory clutter. Allow sufficient time for auditory processing. Consider your rate of speech. Use a multisensory approach, but consider the limits of simultaneous multisensory input. That one sounds a little paradoxical. I'll talk about that. Consider the significance of suprasegmental phonemes in comprehension of language and spoken language. And finally, support localization by drawing attention to sound sources. So those are some interventions to consider. Okay, so let's start with decreased auditory clutter. There are many ways that we can do that. We can improve the acoustics in a classroom. So we can cover up areas of the classroom that don't serve to provide a good acoustic environment. And we can do that by just hanging cheap curtains made of, like, I don't know, bed sheets that you buy at the dollar store. That you can go online and see lots of videos of teachers that will show you in classrooms how to cover up bookshelves or other areas of the classroom to make the classroom acoustics better. And some of these strategies are also done to reduce visual clutter for kids who are easily distracted. So they may have a big bookshelf with full of books, and they keep that covered most of the time, unless the kids need access to the book, so the kids aren't distracted by all the visual clutter of all the books. You can put the famous or the well-known strategy of putting tennis balls on the feet of the chairs in the classroom, so that the chairs make less noise. You can, I said in the article, you can do things like establishing set times for activities like pencil sharpening. So that a child doesn't start sharpening their pencil just at the moment that the child who is having trouble processing language really needs to pay attention. And just in general, you can just think about times when you're saying something really important and make sure that at that moment the environment is as optimal as it possibly can be. So if you're here in California, we have a lot of special education classrooms that are out in bungalows, and a lot of the bungalows, because they're not hooked up to the school, they have a heating and or cooling unit that hangs down from the ceiling, and it It's about the size of a big washing machine that just hangs from the ceiling. And when those things come on, oh my gosh, it's really loud. So if you're a teacher and you're going to say something like, children, I have some very good news for you. If you are very good this morning during circle time, the class next door has invited us to and then all of a sudden the heating unit goes on and it sounds like a small jet engine. And that would be a good time to realize that as much as that child or those children may have wanted to hear what you had to say at that moment, they may have missed it. And so nobody wants the heating unit to come on right when you get to the point that says, so the class next door has invited us to that would be a terrible, terrible point to lose auditory information. So there are a lot of things you can do in a program, both to improve the acoustics and also to just think about times when you're saying something particularly important. If you're teaching a new skill, introducing new vocabulary, giving important directions about something that's going to be happening, those are times when you want to make sure that you have the best auditory environment you can. Okay, so another way that people do this is by using sound field systems. And sound field systems, this is a graphic I just pulled off the internet. But sound field systems are typically, if you've never been around one, typically maybe four speakers in a classroom. So there'll be a speaker in each of the four corners of a classroom. And the person speaking, so it could be the teacher, it could be a paraeducator, it could be a fellow student, a peer in the classroom. Whoever is speaking wears a microphone, and the speaker's voice is amplified through the speakers, but in a fairly minimal way. So it's not like a PA system at a ball game. It's not that kind of amplification. It's just a slight boost or gain. And if you've never been in a classroom with sound field systems, I encourage you to check one out. It's really quite remarkable. I just love them because I can hear like I'm 12 years old again. You know, I no longer have age-related and noise-induced hearing loss. So I hear like I did when I was a kid. There are other types of sound field system. This particular one, which I've never experienced, seems to be in the ceiling. There's a company called Red Cat, which is popular here in California, and it's a single speaker that is about the size of an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper that sits somewhere in the classroom, and the company claims that it covers the room with sound as well as multiple speakers do. I don't know if that's true, but you'll see lots of different sound field systems.
Hey, Maurice, let's go ahead and do an interpreter switch.
Maurice, this is Anna speaking. There's one question in the chat box that I wanted to read. It's a good question. I'm from Ryan, and it says, is it possible to diagnose this with a child who has profound sensory or neural hearing loss due to CMV? How do you know if it's just a delay in the hearing loss versus CAPD?
Okay, so the child is communicating orally, they have a profound hearing loss due to CMV.
Ryan, can you add, okay. Still a baby, so nonverbal.
Yes, it would be impossible to diagnose this. Again, the CAPD can only be diagnosed in children who have acquired language.
Okay.
And never in infants and toddlers. really very rarely in preschoolers. Generally in the among all students, including general ed students, auditory processing disorders typically aren't diagnosed until children are a little bit older, because that's when the problems are seen. You know, it's similar to the, and I'm not a TVI, but for those of you who are TVIs, you know that that it's when print gets, when children are in school and they reach a grade, whenever that is in their program, when their print starts getting small, or when the contrast, when they're expected to start reading books that don't address contrast as well as books for very young readers do, that, you know, all of a sudden, that's when kids find out that they need reading glasses, you know, for just to be in school. So it's similar to CAPD. It's that age when all of a sudden a teacher says, I don't think this child is processing what I'm saying in a typical way. So I hope that answers the question, but we can talk more at the end if there's more questions about that. I'm happy to talk more. Okay, then of course, so similar to a sound field amplification system, what we used to call FM systems, and now in California, more people are calling remote microphone technology or RMT, because most of these systems are no longer FM, but Bluetooth or something else. So just a typical RMT system where the speaker speaks into, has a microphone, and the signal goes directly into the child's hearing aid. And so obviously that helps reduce auditory clutter, because the child is hearing just what the speaker is saying. This is something that I've just started to notice, and that is bone conduction headphones. And we've had bone conduction hearing aids for decades, and I've always wondered why in our capitalist consumer-driven system in the United States, why industry has never caught on to how great bone conduction devices can be. And so now all of a sudden I'm seeing more and more people using bone conduction headphones. And the first time I started seeing it was at my gym back when we used to go to gyms. Remember those days? I would see more and more people wearing bone conduction hearing aids, because it allows them to listen to music while they exercise, but not to block their ear canals so that they can talk, which is, for many people at my gym, it seems to be the main reason why they're at the gym, is they're there to talk. So this allows them to listen to music and yak. There's lots of ways to address getting the sound directly from the speaker to the child. But those are just some of the issues around auditory clutter. If you have questions about that, we can talk about those at the end. Okay, allow sufficient time for auditory processing. This is something that we talk a lot about with teachers and paraeducators and specialists who come in and out of a classroom, who are often in a hurry, trying to keep a schedule, and needing things to just move along at a quick pace. And sometimes it is very hard to take the time to allow for extra auditory processing time. And sometimes when I'm doing technical assistance, I will have people experience how long 30 seconds is after you've done something like asked a student to stand up. So you say, you tell the student, it's time to get ready for recess. I need you to stand up so you can walk with me over to the ball box or whatever. And then wait 30 seconds and see how long 30 seconds feels. And it's one thing to do it in the context of a webinar like this, but in a busy classroom when you've got a lot of other things to do and other students that you're responsible for and to supervise, 30 seconds can seem like an eternity. But 30 seconds is not unusual at all. It's not an unusual processing lag for many of the students that we serve. So just something to remember if people report, if a family reports that they think the child needs 15, 30, sometimes even 45 seconds or a minute to process spoken language, that can feel like a very long time when you're actually trying to run a program. Okay, next, consider your rate of speech. Years ago, I had the opportunity to hear just a very interesting guy named Dr. Ray Hull. He's at Wichita State University, and he has given multiple presentations at our Office of Special Education Programs project directors meetings in Washington, and I've had the chance to meet him now a few times. And from him, I got interested in this idea of central nervous system limitations of processing the acoustic language elements of speech. And this is what Ray Hull has found from years and years of research in his field, that preschool children cannot process spoken language at a rate faster than about 124 words per minute. So that's pretty remarkable. When you go up in age, so the primary grades in elementary school, even then, children can only process language at 124 to 128 words per minute. In the upper elementary grades, it increases to 128 to 130 words per minute. Middle school is 135 to 140 words per minute. And high school is approximately 145 words per minute. And this is the example that Ray Hull gives. He says, many of us are speaking faster to children than their brains can process. And here's the example he gives, which I just think is hysterical. So I've stolen it from him. He says, imagine you're a parent and you go into your kid's bedroom and you say to them, oh my gosh, grandma just called and she's on her way over here and the house is a mess. I need you to pick up your room, get everything off the floor, make your bed, and help me get the house picked up because grandma's going to be here any minute. I don't want her to see the house like this. You shut the door, you run around the house, you go back in 5 minutes, and the kids are still sitting there on the floor playing. And you say, didn't you hear what I said? I said, grandma's on her way. She just called. She's going to be over here in just a minute. So hurry, hurry, get everything picked up. You leave, you come back in 2 or 3 minutes and they're still sitting there. And in exasperation, you say, didn't you hear me? I said, pick up your room. And the kids say, oh, okay, why didn't you just ask? And it's that when you finally slow down to a rate that they can understand, all of a sudden, it makes sense to them. And there is one well-known person in popular culture who was a master at speaking at 124 words per minute. And if I was in a face-to-face room with you, I would ask you to guess, but I can't do that because we can't unmute you. So I'm just going to show you who it is. And it is, oh, wait, it's not that. Sorry, I have a slide in between there. But yeah, I'll get to that in just a second. But Ray Hull has found that elementary school teachers on average speak between about 160, 180 words per minute. And mothers, and he's only studied mothers, speak at rates exceeding 170 words per minute. So both teachers and parents speak to children at a rate faster than they can understand. And did a big California symposium a couple of weekends ago, and we had a very distinguished ophthalmologist from the UK speak, my colleague Julie Meyer and I were talking the other day to the woman who captioned that talk, and I was afraid to ask her how she did and how awful it was. But she said something like he was speaking at about 260 words per minute, and technical language, which made it very hard to process. So the point is that many of us are speaking to children at a rate faster than their brains can actually process the information, and here is the master of speakers at 124 words per minute, and that is the wonderful Fred Rogers. And much in the way that Barbara Mandrell was country when country wasn't cool, that's a little something for you Nashville folks. I have been asking students at San Francisco State to study Fred Rogers and learn from Fred Rogers long before it was hip to like Fred Rogers. now it's hip to be a Fred Rogers fan. But years ago I was saying, listen to Fred Rogers. And so I have a clip of Fred Rogers here. And I hope it's going to play. I'll find out in a minute. If it doesn't, it will. Okay, good. This is Fred Rogers in 1997, and he is being awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award at the Emmys. And so here he is. I'm going to let you listen to about a minute of him talking. And what I think is so remarkable is that you can see from this clip, this is not him on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. So it's not him filming his TV show. This is him actually just being himself at Radio City Music Hall with literally thousands and thousands of people in the audience. And I want you to listen to the way that Fred Rogers talks. I think it is just simply remarkable. And I'm going to start it and then move it up to about the 1 minute, 20 second mark and bypass the introduction. So 1 second here.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, it's a beautiful night in this neighborhood. So many people have helped me to come to this night. Some of you are here, some are far away, some are even in heaven. All of us have special ones who have loved us into being. Would you just take, along with me, 10 seconds to think of the people who have helped you become who you are? Those who have cared about you and wanted what was best for you in life. 10 seconds of silence. I'll watch the time. Whomever you've been thinking about, how pleased they must be to know the difference you feel they've made. You know, they're the kind of people television does well to offer our world.
So that's Fred Rogers speaking at Radio City Music Hall, and he has complete control over this audience of people who are probably more used to them doing the talking than listening to somebody else. Of course, it's because he's Fred Rogers and he was an icon in television. But I also have to believe, in part, this is due to the fact that he is speaking at a rate that people, that helps people fully understand every single thing he says. And I often think when I'm speaking, and I'm not very good at it, but I try to slow down and think, how would Fred Rogers say this? It's good to keep him in the back of your mind. So I found an example of a set of directions from a commercially available published curriculum, elementary school curriculum. This is an example of directions that a teacher might read to their class, and it is exactly 124 words. And I thought, oh, this is perfect. So what I thought I would do is I would ask somebody in the audience to try it and see if you can speak at a rate that is close to, as close as you can get to 124 words per minute. So I believe we have a volunteer, and that's Dana, right?
That's correct.
Dana. Okay, so Dana courageously volunteered to be the person who's going to read this. So Dana, what I want you to do is just speak at a rate that sounds like the way Fred Rogers would say it.
Okay.
And I am going to watch the time on my clock. So you can start whenever you want and just go all the way to the end. Okay.
So okay. I'm not going to be as good as the master, but I'm going to try.
Okay.
Okay. If you look in the middle of your groups of desks, you will see a group number. Your numbers are on the board and on the book baskets. You will receive points on the board when I catch you being good. If your group is kind and quiet, I might give you a point. If your group is the first to be ready, when I give the signal, I might give your group a point. At the end of the day, we will count the points to see which group has the most points. The group with the most points gets a star on their chart from the star monitor. When you fill your chart, you get to go shopping in our class store.
Okay, so that was about closer to 45 seconds.
Oh gosh, and I was talking so slow, I thought.
Yeah, I thought you did very well.
Thank you.
Because I think to ask somebody to speak at the rate you just did would be to ask a lot of somebody. And Dana, did you try to slow down, or when you talk to kids, would you be speaking at a faster rate, do you think?
I think I definitely speak at a faster rate than that.
Okay.
But when I'm reading a story, I feel like I go slower.
Right. And that's good, because we want children to process language in a story, obviously. That's important. But okay, thank you, Dana. I appreciate
You're welcome.
It. Now, person, the more I use this example, I've used this example maybe 5 or 6 times. I think I need to change it out. I don't really like the way the teacher says, if your group is kind and quiet, I might give you a point. I don't know. It sounds too subjective. I say, if the group is quiet, they get the point. You know, once you add that word might into it, if I was a little kid, I'd be the first one raising my hand and saying, now, wait a minute, we might get a point. You know, what are you going to consider when you try to decide whether or not we deserve points? Okay. But that's speaking at a rate, that's slow enough so that children can process information. Okay, before I move on, I want to talk about, and I wonder if I can just back up a little bit. I should have put in another slide, but that last bullet there, I don't have a slide for use a multisensory approach, but consider the limits of simultaneous multisensory input. But what I mean by that, and why I said it's a little bit paradoxical, is that we want to make sure that we are using a multisensory approach because that's just good teaching. And so we want to meet the needs of kids who are auditory learners, visual learners, tactile learners, whatever. With lots of hands-on experiences and real experiences with real materials in real locations with real people and with real consequences and all of those things we do as teachers. But we also want to consider the limits of simultaneous multisensory input. And just in the same way, if you're familiar with CVI and the way that many children who have and individuals who have CVI are taking information best when it doesn't overwhelm all of the senses at once. So, for example, children with CVI may seem more deaf when they are really visually focused on something, or when a child is exploring something with their hands, they may be not looking at it as carefully and not listening to what you're saying quite as much. So children are very good at shutting off other sensory avenues when they're really concentrating on one, children who have CVI. And in some ways, that's true of all children and even all, you know, all people. I mean, you know, if I'm in San Francisco with a car full of screaming children and I'm trying to parallel park on a really steep hill, you know, I might turn around and say, could you be quiet for just a minute? I have to concentrate. I just can't take all of that auditory stimulation when I'm trying to fit my car into this tiny little parking space on a steep hill. So it's really true of all people. But in terms of central auditory processing disorder, when a child is really listening, that may not be the time to also expect them to be doing something like following along in print or exploring something tactually. So it's that same idea of I'm hesitant to ever say limit simultaneous multisensory input because then I'm afraid people will get the idea, well, then I should, if they have CAPD, then I should only, and they have CVI, then I should only do tactile activities and I should never do anything that involves auditory or visual information. It's not that, it's using the multisensory approach, but just not expecting children to use their all of those senses at the same time. So let me go back now. Okay, so here's the fifth intervention to consider. Consider the significance of suprasegmental phonemes in comprehension. And suprasegmental phonemes, for those of you who aren't speech and language specialists or perhaps deaf and hard of hearing teachers, suprasegmental phonemes are the parts of spoken language that convey meaning beyond the actual words and their definitions. And there are a number of suprasegmental phonemes, but just for the purposes of talking about it today, I've chosen five of them: stress, juncture, pitch, tone, and tempo. So let me give you an example of these. So stress. So in spoken English, stress plays an important part in the way that we convey meaning. So I can take the sentence, let me think of one. Okay, so here's, think of this sentence. You ate all that. So depending on which of those four words I stress, that sentence has four very different meanings. So the first, I can stress you and say, you ate all that, suggesting that I thought it might have been somebody else and I'm surprised it was you. You ate all that. So whatever else you could have done with it, you ate it. You ate all that, meaning you ate the whole thing. I'm shocked that you didn't leave anything behind. Or you ate all that, suggesting that I'm surprised at whatever it is you chose to eat. So you can take those four simple words, and depending on where you put the stress, it changes the meaning. Juncture is I'll show you a reason why juncture is a particular problem for me. But juncture is in spoken language, it's separating words so that it's clear to the listener where one word ends and the next word begins. Because we have many examples in English where if you speak too quickly, the words run together and it can be confusing to the child. So the most famous example is ice cream. So ice cream can either be ice cream, like the cold stuff you eat, or I scream, like I yell. I thought of another example this morning when I was walking my dog. That stuff. When I say that stuff, I mean that stuff, over there on the table, or it can also sound like that's tough. Like, oh, that's too bad. That's tough. Too bad. And I have a particular problem with juncture because sadly, my parents gave me a name where my first name ends with a S sound and my last name begins with a B sound. And in English, we don't have very many words that go directly from an S sound to a B sound. It doesn't really work that well in English. So I went to a vision conference years ago and I gave them my name and I said it out loud and they said, what is your name? And I said, Maurice Belote. And this is the name that ended up on my name tag, Maury Splote. And ever since I had the indignity of going through a conference with the name Maury Splote on my name badge, I've always been extra careful when I say my name to actually put a little time break in between my first and last name to make it a little bit clearer.
Maurice, let's go ahead and do an interpreter switch, please.
So another suprasegmental phoneme is pitch. Many spoken languages around the world use pitch much more than English does, but English does use pitch a lot more than people realize. And the most common example is this idea that children can tell the difference between a question and a command, because people will say, when you ask a question, the pitch in your voice goes up at the end. And when you say a command, it doesn't. Well, actually, that's not true. In English, the only questions where the pitch goes up at the end, and I'm talking, you know, the majority culture of people who speak English, especially native English speakers, the only questions where the pitch goes up are yes and no questions. So most other questions, the pitch does not go up, it actually goes down. So questions that begin with what, where, why, when, who, the pitch actually goes down. So if you go into your children's room and it's a mess, you would ask the question, who made this giant mess? You wouldn't say, I don't even know if I can do it. Let me try it. Who made this giant mess? You know, it wouldn't make any sense. So pitch is an important part of spoken language and something that conveys a lot of meaning beyond the words. And then finally, the last two suprasegmental phonemes I've included here are tone. So how we say things. Like, do we say it with anger in our voice or with frustration or bitterness or sadness or happiness or joy? So the tone that we say things is very important in conveying meaning. And then finally, the tempo. So we use tempo to express meaning. We speed things up. We slow things down. We slow down a single word in a sentence to draw attention to that one word that's most important. So there are a lot of ways that we use tempo in English in ways that we probably aren't even aware of. So I put these up here just to remind you that that suprasegmental phonemes play an important part in the way that we convey messages and in the way that children receive messages. So it's not just the words, it's all the other components of making ourselves understood. And then finally, before we, let me look at my notes here. Yeah, so I'm gonna do one little activity at the end, and then we'll have plenty of time for questions. So finally, the last bullet here is support localization by drawing attention to sound sources. So many children with auditory processing disorders have trouble localizing sounds. And we can help children by helping them know where the sound is coming from, whether it's an environmental sound or whether it's somebody speaking or whatever. And so I want to pay particular attention here to something called the cone of confusion. Cone of confusion. Not to be confused with the cone of silence. I just thought of that last night. I thought, oh, the cone of silence. If you don't know what that is, you're not a Buck Henry fan, but that was from the old television show from my youth called Get Smart. But the cone of confusion is a component of sound localization. The way, if we have typical hearing, typically developed hearing, there are a number of ways that the ear and the brain, the ears and the brain uses to localize sound. And I don't want to get into the science of it, because mainly I don't understand it that well, because it's not my field. But in general, it has to do with how loud a sound is, and the distance of the speaker. So a sound coming from one side of my head is going to go into one ear faster than it's going to go into the other ear. And even though that difference is truly minuscule, that the brain detects that difference and it helps us understand where sound is coming from. It's also a feature of pitch or frequency in a sound. So there's differences in distance, in loudness, in frequency, and our brain takes all of that information and puts it together and tells us where a sound is coming from. But we all have this thing called the cone of confusion. And if you think about it, if you imagine you're looking straight ahead, imagine you have two highway, like those orange pylons that they put on the highway. Imagine you have two highway pylons with the pointy end at your ear and then going out to the wider end straight out from your head. The two sides horizontally of that widest part of the pylon, and the two opposing sides top and bottom of the pylon, our brains cannot distinguish the difference between the two horizontal points and the two vertical points, because sound from either one is reaching our two ears in exactly the same way. And that is called the cone of confusion. And the reason why I worry about the cone of confusion is because of kids who are wheelchair users. So kids who have CVI and might have CAPD and may not have the ability to choose to move their head. And that's as humans, if we have typically developed hearing, the way that we compensate for the cone of confusion is by constantly moving our head so that the points that the sound is coming from aren't always in the same place, and that helps us localize. But I worry about those kids who don't have the benefit of being able to move their head voluntarily. So they're in a wheelchair with head supports, and so they may the cone of confusion might impact them more than it would a child who has voluntary movement and can move their head to compensate for this cone of confusion. That's just a quick little delve into the whole science of sound, but something to keep in mind that we can help kids know where a sound source is coming from if they have CAPD. And then finally, I'm just going to close with talking about context before we take questions. So this is a story that was written in 1940 by a guy named Howard L. Chase. And this story, if you're not familiar with it, just bear with me for a minute. The story is called Ladle, Rat, Rotten Hut. And let me just read you the first paragraph here. These are all real words in English. And to our interpreters, however you want to figure out some of these, they are real words. I actually had to look up cordage because I I didn't know that word. It has to do with lines and ropes on a ship. I didn't believe it was a word. Anyway, this was written in 1940. Listen to these words. Wants, pawn, term, dare, worsted, ladle, gull, hoe, lift, wetter, murder, inner, ladle, cordage, honor, he must have been British, itch, offer, lodge, dock, florist. Okay, you get the idea. Let me read the next sentence. Disc, ladle, gull, orphan, worry, ladle, cluck, wetter, putty, ladle, rat hut, and fur, disc, raisin, pimple, colder, ladle, rat, rotten, hut. Okay. Words that seem to be, that seem to don't have any connection. But let me provide you a little context. What if I told you that ladle, rat, rotten hut is actually Little Red Riding Hood? Now, listen to this story again, knowing that ladle, rat, rotten hut is a little girl in a red cape. Once upon term, der worsted ladle gull, ho lift wetter murder in her ladle cordage, on her itch off her lodge, dock florist. Dis ladle gull, orphan wore ladle cluck, wetter purty ladle rat hut. And for disc raisin, pimple colder, ladle rat rotten hut. Okay, so my guess is that you probably understood this a little bit better. And then finally, what I'm going to give you the real words to this, and I'm going to read it again and just follow along. Once upon term, der worsted ladle gull, ho lift wetter murder in her ladle cordage, on her itch off her lodge dock florist. Disc ladle gull, orphan worry ladle cluck with her putty ladle rat hut. And for disc raisin, pimple colder ladle rat rotten hut. So in addition to everything else that we've talked about today, I do want you to remember context. Because context is very important for understanding. And if any of you speak a second or third language, then you know that it's a lot easier to follow along when you're listening in that language when you understand the context. And if somebody suddenly changes the topic that they're talking about in a way that you don't expect, it's hard to figure out what's happened and pick up again in a way that keeps you connected to the conversation. So one of the most important things we can do is to always think about context and make sure that we are providing context for, especially for oral language that's particularly important. As I said at the beginning, instructions, new concepts, particularly important things or exciting things that the child is going to want to know. So finally, I just have one of my favorite quotes from Peter Schultes. Sometimes things are the way they are because they got that way. I love this quote for a lot of reasons, but in particular for central auditory processing. Sometimes services are provided or not provided simply because it's always been that way, and why it got that way in the first place, nobody knows because it was so long ago. But if you are in a situation where you are dealing with children who you suspect might have auditory processing, even though they can't be diagnosed, and even though we would never say it out loud, if you are doing that, then there are things you can do that will help these kids. And that's my main point. And I didn't originally write this article for the DeafBlind world, for the DeafBlind our project or the other projects. I originally wrote this because I would go into classrooms to provide technical assistance for a child who's deafblind. But you know how it is if you've ever been a technical assistance provider. There are times when you have other things to do. So the child that you're there to see goes into the bathroom and they're there for 30 minutes. Well, you're not just going to stand there and do nothing. So I'll interact with the other kids. I'll observe the other kids. I'll offer to help the teacher. And I started seeing a lot of kids who the teachers would say, oh, that child you're interacting with, they have CVI. And I say, oh, that's interesting. But through my interaction, I'm noticing that they are also not responding to speech and sounds in a typical way. And so it's originally I thought this isn't a deaf-blind issue because the students that we serve are already diagnosed with a vision issue and a hearing issue. And I was thinking about those other kids who maybe have only been diagnosed with CVI, but and whose teams are just assuming they can compensate with auditory activities, and maybe they shouldn't be making that assumption. But perhaps, and this is just a perhaps this really does have more relevance in the deafblind world. I'm not sure. But we can talk about that and figure it out as a field. So thank you very much. I hope that gave you some new insights and ways of thinking about your practice. And now we'll take questions if there are any.
Okay, this is your opportunity again to go ahead and ask our awesome presenter any questions you might have. And let's see. In the meantime, Maurice, do you have any closing comments?
I would only say in closing that I originally started thinking about this and wanting to talk more and more about it because I didn't see that that this is really being addressed in our field. I searched for information about combined CVI and CAPD. The only place I found information about it was on the CVI Scotland website, which is, if you haven't seen the CVI Scotland website, and I don't know if Chris Russell talked about it, but it really is excellent. So there's some information there, but this is not something that's been talked about a lot. And I'm surprised at that because of how many risk factors are common between CVI and CAPD. But this is my 39th year as a teacher of the deafblind, and I just thought of it I just really started paying attention to it in 2019. Maybe it's a big deal. Maybe it's not as a big deal as I think. I don't know. I'm just sort of throwing it out there. But again, as I keep saying, we would never suggest to a parent, I think your child has CAPD. We would never say that. All we would do is think, okay, if it seems this child is not responding typically to sound or language, so maybe there are some things I can do to help the child. And as I said, they will do no harm. Not only will they not do harm, they will support all kids. Everybody benefits from slower speech, reduced auditory clutter, all of those things.
So Maurice, this is Marilyn speaking. And again, that's why I didn't read that little article, because I can't go slow. So, and I know I can't. I know my limitations. But Joan asked in here, just to clarify, did you mention that CAPD is well received by professionals and teachers or not? From my experience, I've had many professionals question the validity of CAPD.
Well, so unlike auditory neuropathy, which does still have some disagreement, professional disagreements and arguments, there's no question that CAPD exists. It is an issue where the ears work okay, but the brain is not processing the sound. Now that you've asked this, I'm going to go ahead and say it, and you can all throw virtual daggers at me if you want, but I'm going to say it, that the world of blindness and visual impairments, decades ago, CVI was a radical concept, that this idea that the eyes are fine, but the brain is not processing visual information. And what role do teachers of the blind and visually impaired play in supporting kids who have CVI? Well, now it would be almost laughable to suggest that teachers of students who are blind and visually impaired wouldn't serve kids with CVI. In fact, CVI is considered the number one cause of visual impairment among children now. But CAPD is not recognized in that same way yet. More so in the speech and language world, much less so in the DHH world. So I wonder if years from now, DHH teachers will be trained and have knowledge and skills in brain-based hearing issues. I don't know. But right now, the DHH world, if I bring up central auditory processing disorder in a group of DHH administrators and teachers, boy, everybody sits up real fast and is very quick to explain to me that that is not what they do.
So Maurice, this is Marilyn speaking. We have here Ryan. I'm assuming, if a child has cochlear implants, are the interventions generally the same? My daughter has CVI and will have cochlear implants. So trying to figure out how to best approach if she does have CAPD as well.
And again, I would just say to Ryan, was that his name? Ryan, I would just say, Ryan, what I'm saying are just good practices in general. So if you are a fast talker, and if you can slow down, and maybe not slow down all the time, but slow down when it's most important, or slow down when you can't control auditory clutter. Like, so if you're in a noisy environment, that's the time to try another strategy. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, a New Yorker, just to let everybody know, he said, well, as a New Yorker, and I'm a Chicago girl, I know it can be very difficult. Maurice, we appreciate your time. We appreciate your energy, and your information is so valuable to our diverse population that are here participating on these webinars. In closing, I do want to say here, because really Robert did say, hit it pretty well, CAPD is pretty universally accepted, which is great to hear. And we are seeing this in the adult services, and people are understanding this more and more. And this is why we keep bringing this webinar topic back to the light, so all of us providers understand that this is out there, and to keep a lookout for that and stop just looking only at what the medical papers say, but to look at our person inside and out. And this is why the collaboration of all of our great partners helps us understand this. Because what Robert also says is neuropathy is a different situation. Often the two are confused interchangeably. Thank you, Robert from South Carolina, our DeafBlind project. And again, thank you everybody for being here. We've gone ahead and put the poll up here. Please take just a minute to go ahead and complete that poll. And again, we thank you for your time. Please stay safe out there. I know a lot of people are stuck under snow, and some people are in ice, while Maurice is there enjoying the sun on his wonderful beginning of his day. So again, Maurice, thank you so much for your time. Thank you to the interpreters. Thank you, audience, for being here. And we will go ahead and see you all next week. Don't forget to share the information about the upcoming webinars that are scheduled for the next several weeks ahead, because we have more in store for you.
Thank you, Marilyn. So long.